Good evening. A very, very warm welcome to all the audiences. And I would like to invite our guest speaker today. The topic that we've chosen is extremely relevant for today's times. And I'm sure a lot of you may have observed that your relative or your parents probably pop a pill whenever they feel they are unwell, or if they have a headache, they will ask their neighbor, or probably they ask somebody on the phone, a relative, and pop the pill. A lot of times I have also noticed, and I'm sure you have noticed as well, that whenever people have a problem, instead of going to the doctor directly, first they will take some prescription on the phone and pop it up. So today we are going to be discussing about, you know, why self-medication may be harmful to you all. And I am very happy to invite our guest speaker, Dr. Anant Patil. He's a very dear friend and a very known doctor. I will give a little bit of introduction about Dr. Anant Patil. Dr. Anant Patil is an MD in pharmacology. And he is a professor with the D.Y. Patil University School of Medicine. He has an experience of working with pharmaceutical industry and in academics both. So I have had a privilege of working with him in the past. And it's been a pleasure to have him around. He is on the editorial board member of three journals and was recently appointed as the review editor for skin allergy section of the prestigious global newly launched journal Frontiers in Allergy. He authored and presented several papers in national and international journals and conferences, authored almost all types of papers, including meta-analysis, systematic review, original articles, review articles, letter to the editor, health magazine, and website. He's assisted many authors for writing their papers. In over 40 articles, he has been acknowledged by authors for medical writing support. He has experience of organizing many conferences and continued medical education, and has been invited for several conferences and workshops. He has completed simulation instructor comprehensive course by Mayo Clinic USA, and he loves medical writing, and patient awareness is his forte. So I want to welcome Dr. Anant. Thank you so much for agreeing to come. And the topic that is picked up is very relevant for these times.
So thank you, Hema, for this kind words and introduction. And absolutely, I also had a pleasure working with you together. Just to make one correction in the CV that you elaborated extensively, I'm currently working as an assistant professor in the Department of Pharmacology.
Okay.
And the topic that you chose today is extremely relevant and dear to my heart. This is why, because this is socially important topic, as well as it is medically important topic. And as much as we can do to increase awareness about self-medication, I think efforts, they should be enhanced at all levels, be it at the level of educators, be it at the level of regulatory authorities, be it at the level of the patient group. So everybody should be knowing what are the kind of adverse implications of self-medication. So thank you so much for bringing this topic for discussion on this platform. Thank you.
Pleasure of mine. So Dr. Anant, can you please tell us, for people who are watching, and you know, everybody has a different definition of what is self-medication. Can you please tell us what is self-medication actually, and what are the different types of self-medication that you normally see in your practice?
So just to give a brief background about what self-medication is. Self-medication basically is a human behavior. And it's a human behavior for treating the self-diagnosed disease. For example, if I get some symptoms, I would have heard somewhere, I would have read somewhere. So I do not go to doctor for getting prescription. and I take the pill on my own. So that is one kind of self-medication. So if I have a newly diagnosed disease, which is kind of minor disease, I would say, so there people tend to self-medicate themselves. The second self-medication is for people who are suffering from chronic diseases. And they have been on some treatment for a long time. But in between, sometimes they might use medication on their own. So this is also a kind of self-medication. So self-medication can be for the diseases which are of short duration, or some people, they use self-medication even for the diseases which are for long duration. And what are the kind of medications that people usually self-medicate with? Mostly, if you see the formulations, we have the injectables and the oral formulations. Even we have the topical formulations. So most of the self-medication is with the, as expected, obviously, with the oral formulations, either tablets or the capsules, or it could be in the form of a topical application. Rarely people would self-medicate with injection, because injections would only some kind of assistance or expertise. So self-medication usually is with the oral formulations or with the topical application kind of medications, that I would say.
Okay. Okay. So also, can you talk a little bit about, why do people do this? You know, why is it so easy to self-medicate, especially in a country like India? I think it's very rampant. You know?
So I don't think only India is having a problem of self-medication, because self-medication is a global phenomenon. So whether it is a developed country, whether it's a developing country, across the world, this phenomena or this problem exists. The prevalence or the rates of self-medication might differ. So in developing countries as well as developed countries, everywhere people, they self-medicate. Now coming to question of why. Obviously, as I said, it is a human behavior. Now, there could be several reasons again. And these reasons might also change based on the study that you're doing in which population. So are you conducting a study in a rural population? So the reasons would be different. If you're conducting a study in urban populations, the reasons might be different. If you're conducting a study in educated people, the reasons might be different. If you're conducting a study in illiterate population, the reasons might be different. So broadly, if you ask me what are the reasons for self-medication, especially as you said, in developing countries. One of the major reason is skewed ratio of doctor versus patient. And poor healthcare access could be one of the reasons why people, they kind of try to self-medicate themselves, because they might not have access to the healthcare professionals or the healthcare facilities. Mm-hmm. That could be one. Second could be because you get medications easily on the pharmacies, if there are stringent regulation, if I don't get medication easily at the pharmacy, I won't self-medicate myself. I would obviously have to go to a doctor. Mm-hmm. So that could be the second reason for self-medication. The third reason for self-medication could be because I have good experience in the past. I had used the same kind of formulation in the past. I remember that that drug worked very well on me. Mm-hmm. Why I should go to a doctor? So that could be thinking of some people, and they try to kind of use the same medication against when they get a disease for the next time. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people, they tend to follow their peers or their friends or maybe family members. So somebody says, in my family, suppose my father or mother, she suffered from that disease and she got relief from that particular medication. So there is a general tendency that people think that if my mother, brother or sister got relief, I will also get it. And then they use the same medication. Third could be, instead of going to a doctor, they might go to a pharmacist and tell him the symptoms. I am suffering from, say, runny nose. I'm suffering from itchy skin. Could you please guide me and give me some medication? So that saves on their cost of consulting a doctor. So that could be another reason why people self-medicate.
Yeah.
Another reason why people self-medicate could be because they want to save on the money. If they go to a doctor, they think that they would have to spend some amount of money. So that could be another reason of self-medication. Next reason for self-medication is they have money, but they don't have time. So, for example, I'm so busy, I'm traveling, I don't have time to go to doctors. So that could be another reason for self-medication. Third could be unavailability of doctors. Sometimes you know that there is an emergency or in the middle of the night you get some kind of symptom and you don't have access to healthcare practitioners. So where do I go? So I obviously tend to look for the resources from where I can get the information and I try to self-medicate. So there are several reasons, as I said. It all depends upon what is the scenario or what is the social background in which you are studying. So there are several reasons for this.
Yeah. Also, this brings me to a question, you know, does self-medication, is that limited to certain strata of society? As in, have you seen it across or it is more in one strata versus another?
It is seen across the strata. I have no doubt about it. It is seen in rural population. It is seen in urban population.
Right.
It is seen in educated people. It is seen in uneducated people.
Right.
Educated people because they read a lot on the social platforms. If I go to Google, I get all information about a particular drug.
Yeah.
So because they have some understanding about the drug or the medicine or the disease, that would stimulate them to go for a self-medication.
Hmm.
On the other hand, the illiterate ones, they might get influenced by somebody.
Hmm.
Because somebody in the family or the peer, why are you going to a doctor?
Hmm.
This drug worked for me, so why don't you also try these drugs? So illiterate have different reasons for self-medication. Literate have different reasons for self-medication. But the problem exists in across. For example, male and female.
Hmm.
Male also self-medicate, females also self-medicate.
Yeah, yeah,
okay. The adult also self-medicate, elderly also self-medicate.
Hmm.
So the reasons would be different, but it is across the strata, whether it's a socio-economic, whether it's a gender, whether it's a geography, across it is seen.
Right. Which is so interesting because this is like across, and you know, it's a problem which is across the world as well. So, Dr. Anand, also we would like to know what are the commonest, you know, harms that people do when they self-medicate?
Okay. I think this is one of the interesting questions, and I would like to take a little bit more time on this question because this is why people should not self-medicate themselves.
Yes.
Now, if I see what are the harms with self-medication, the harms are varied. If you broadly classify them, the harms can be of two types, because of self-medication or because of any medication for that matter, whether it is given by a doctor or whether self-medicated. One is called as the predicted adverse event, and the other is called as the unpredicted adverse event. Now, what is meaning of predicted adverse event is that I know what is the pharmacology of the drug. I know how the drug is going to act in my body. And based on that, I can predict that person might develop these kind of adverse effects. So these are called as the predicted ones. Now, worrisome is unpredicted adverse events, which mostly we do not understand and we do not know which person will get these kind of adverse effects. These are called as the unpredictable. So medically, they are called as the type A reactions and the type B reactions. So unpredictable ones are the B reactions. Now let's talk about what are the predicted reactions and what are the unpredicted reactions. Now predicted reactions, one is called as the side effect. Now side effect is what I give a drug, I give it as normal dose. I do not exceed the dose. I do not exceed the duration. But still, some patients, they develop adverse effect. Why? Because it is called as side effect. So along with the effect, you're going to have a side effect of that drug. So that is called as the predicted. And based on that, I can guide the patient saying that, say, see, I'm prescribing you this drug and this drug is going to act by this mechanism. And because of this mechanism, you will get relief from your symptoms. But at the same time, you are likely to suffer from some kind of adverse implications, but don't worry because I know this is going to happen. So you and me can work together to reduce this kind of adverse effect. So that is called as side effect. The second type of predicted adverse effect would be toxic reactions. In case somebody takes the drug in high quantity, there are chances that the person might suffer from toxic effects. Now, you, as a doctor, they know what are the toxic effects, possible toxic effect, and what could be the possible treatment for this. Another kind of adverse effect is called as the unpredictable one that I told you. So unpredictable ones are major concerns are of two types. One is called as the idiosyncrasy, and second is called as the allergy. So idiosyncrasy basically is a genetic type of response. Now, I do not know this person is going to react in which manner to a particular drug. The same drug given to two people might react in a different fashion. Why? Because there would be some genetic variation in those people. So this is not a drug-related issue or a patient, the doctor-related issue. This is the issue related to the patient's body and patient's genes. So that nobody can predict unless you know that certain diseases are, or certain drugs, they have certain genetic mechanism for metabolism or kind of action, then you might be careful about them. But in most cases, we don't know that. The second is unpredictable one is the allergic reactions. Now, allergic reactions, these are the immune-mediated reactions. We have immune response in body. So if I get a drug, my body gets sensitized to that particular medicine. Now, if I take the same medication next time, I develop allergic reactions because my body has already developed antibody against that particular drug, and the person might develop allergic reactions. So there are four different types of allergic reactions. We will not go into those kind of classification, but unpredictable ones are idiosyncrasy, which is genetically based, and the allergy, which is immunologically based.
Okay.
Now, the other, there are several of them. For example, a mother is a pregnant and she pops up the pill. There could be chances that the drug might cause teratogenicity. Some drugs, if you take it for very long duration, they might cause the risk of rare diseases like cancer.
Hmm.
Some drugs might cause even genetic damage.
Hmm.
So for a layman to understand, we have a simple classification of adverse effects, which is called as the A, B, C, D, and E. So what the A stands for? A stands for augmented reactions.
Hmm.
Now, augmented reactions means you know the effect of the drug.
Hmm.
Because you're misusing the drug either in a high dose or maybe in a long duration, the response gets augmented.
Hmm.
That means it might cause adverse effects. That is augmented. B is bizarre. So those two types of adverse drug reaction I talked about, unpredictable ones. So those are called as the bizarre responses, allergy and idiosyncrasy. C is continued response. If somebody is taking the drug for long duration, there might be some adverse effects which are of long, unless the person takes it for long duration, those adverse effects may not be seen.
Mm-hmm.
D is delayed response. You have taken the drug and you have stopped the drug or you are taking the drug for a very long period. So that's called as the delayed response. E is called as the end of response. So you stop the drug, the patient has taken it for long duration and suddenly he stops it. So there might be withdrawal symptoms. Like for example, somebody is taking alcohol for very long period and suddenly he stops it.
Mm-hmm.
So there might be withdrawal reaction. So there are different kind of adverse events. So people should understand that every drug will have some kind of adverse drug reaction. It is not necessary that you will suffer or everyone will suffer from that adverse effect.
Mm-hmm.
But we should be aware that there are several kind of reactions or the adverse effect that are possible.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, without consultation of a qualified healthcare practitioner, self-medication should be avoided.
Yeah. Very well said. Dr. Ananda, I also want to understand, I have seen in my relatives, it's very common, and also with my friends who are non-medicos, that they start an antibiotic and after 2 days when they feel better, they stop it. And this is sometimes a prescribed medicine which they don't complete the entire course. I would really want you to talk about this because I think it's a very common phenomena because people think having more medicines is not a good thing to do. That's why if you see benefit in the lesser duration of the prescribed course of the medicine, it should be stopped. Please tell us a little about that.
I think you brought a very relevant issue today. The whole world and more so country like ours, we're struggling for the use of antibiotics in a rational way. And there are several reasons. You may not be able to pinpoint what is the exact reason for antibiotic resistance. So antibiotic resistance is like increasing doctors who are treating, especially in ICU, they might have limited choices of antibiotic if the patient has resistance to all these antibiotics. What should they do? There are two types of microbial, antimicrobial resistance. So one is called as the primary resistance and the other is called as the secondary resistance. Now what is primary resistance is that particular microorganism, whether it is a bacteria or a virus or a fungus, it doesn't respond to antibiotic because the structure of that antimicrobial agent and the mechanism of working doesn't suit for that particular pathogen. So that is called as the primary resistance. So primary resistance is kind of okay because I know that this particular antibiotic is not going to work against this microorganism because that microorganism has a different structure, different pathway, different metabolic response. But what is worrisome is the secondary resistance. Now what is secondary resistance is what you just said about people taking, the doctor has prescribed antibiotics for say 7 days and I feel better after 1 or 2 days and I stop it. Now what happens is that because of the inappropriate use of antibiotic, it might be a lesser duration of course of antibiotic or lesser dose or inappropriate dose. So it could be wrong route of administration, it could be wrong dose, it could be wrong duration of treatment, it could be wrong selection of antibiotic. So these all reasons, they add up to antibiotic resistance. Now, you this time you felt better because you took the drug for 2 days. Mm-hmm. But the microorganism may be still there because you're not completed the course of antibiotic. Mm-hmm. Now, what if you suffer with the same infection next time? Now, that bacteria possibly or might have multiplied in your body mm-hmm. in the presence of antibiotic which you took for lesser duration. Mm-hmm. Now, the microorganism learns how to multiply mm-hmm. in the presence of antibiotic. Mm-hmm. Now, when you take the same antibiotic next time mm-hmm. and suppose same bacteria is present in the body which has learned how to multiply in the presence mm-hmm. of that particular antibiotic, mm-hmm. now that antibiotic will not work because mm-hmm. that bacteria has learned how to fight with this antibiotic. Mm-hmm. Had you taken the prescribed course of antimicrobial, the whole mm-hmm. bacteria in your body might have eradicated and there won't be any population or a subpopulation of bacteria which will be able to survive in the presence of that antibiotic. Mm. So it's very important to know, do not change the schedule of antibiotic, whether it's a dose, whether it's a duration, whether it's a frequency of administration, whether how to take that antibiotic should be taken with what kind of, whether it has to be taken after food. So whatever has been told by the doctor is called as the adherence to the treatment or compliance to the treatment. So it's strongly recommended that patients who are taking antibiotic or for that matter any drug, but it is more so important for antibiotic to adhere to the instructions which are given by the healthcare practitioner for the treatment.
Yeah, very well said. So agar mujhe ekdam layman terms mein batana hai sabko, to matlab it's almost like you know, when you're going on a war, you are showing your tools to the enemy. So जब हम medicine लेते हैं, दो दिन के लिए लेते हैं और थोड़ा सा better feel करते हैं, the medicine or the drug, whatever you've taken, is not enough to eradicate or kill the entire lot of organism. However, you know, it is like showing them what tools you're using. So पता चल जाता है कि टूल्स क्या है और फिर नेक्स्ट टाइम व्हेन यू यूज द सेम मेडिसिन इट विल नॉट वर्क ऑन यू इन सिंपल अप्रोच एंड देन यू विल हैव टू आइदर टेक अ हायर डोज और अ डिफरेंट मेडिसिन यू नो व्हिच इज अ सैड थिंग टू डू सो प्लीज लाइक डॉक्टर अनंत सेज जो भी शेड्यूल दिया है अगर वो आपको बोला गया है लंच के बाद लेना है खाने के बाद लेना है तो उसको चेंज बिल्कुल मत कीजिए दूध के साथ मत लीजिए जूस के साथ मत लीजिए मेडिसिन जिसके साथ लेने कहा है पानी के साथ लेने बोला है तो वो ही कीजिए
जस्ट
Well said, Dr. Anand.
Just to take same point forward,
Yes.
There are some diseases like tuberculosis or HIV.
Yes.
So in these cases, we do not use one antibiotic. We use multiple drugs together. So why do we use multiple drugs together? Because we attack the microorganism from different ways. So that what you said, showing the weapons to the enemy. So if you use only one drug for HIV or TB, the disease is a long-term disease. The bacteria or the virus is there in the body for long duration. If you give one drug, the microorganisms are smarter than the drugs. So they tend to overcome that drug in a short period. So when we attack from different sides, it becomes difficult for that microorganism to learn how to overcome one agent, because there are multiple agents been given. So we try to suppress that particular microorganism by attacking from different sides.
Yeah.
So that may not be required for a short illness courses or minor infections.
Yeah, but it's a very important point that has to be noted. So I have a question in the audience as well, and Hira is asking, what about painkillers? People tend to take painkillers with or without advice, knowing or not knowing the repercussions.
Very, very important questions. I think if you see and study the prevalence of self-medication, which medications are commonly self-medicated by the people? And NSAIDs, which is scientifically called as non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, in a layman term, it's called as analgesic or a painkiller.
Yeah.
So this is one of the categories which is commonly self-medicated by people. So now, coming to why do people self-medicate with analgesics? Because pain is one of the commonest symptoms that the person would have. So simple headache or maybe muscle pain when you are playing, or especially in females, the menstrual problems, like for example, dysmenorrhea. So these are the reasons commonly been found when I have gone through the literature, why people they self-medicate for with analgesics especially. So these are some of the reasons why people they self-medicate. Now, which is very, very important to remember that some people will get relief and very few people will get adverse effects. Now, but who are these people? We do not know. What if I am into that category of few people?
Yeah.
Right? Now, I need to understand what are the likely adverse effects with the pain medications or analgesics. I'm talking about, so there are two different types of analgesics. One is called as the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, and the second is called as the opioid types of analgesics. So people more they self-medicate with NSAIDs. Now NSAIDs, for me, there are two or three very important adverse effects that one has to remember. The first adverse effect very commonly seen with analgesics or the painkillers is the abdominal discomfort in the form of gastritis. Some people might develop peptic ulcer. Some people even go to the extent of getting bleeding or hemorrhage in the intestine, bleeding. So why? Because it is the mechanism of the drug. How does the drug act? In the body, we have an enzyme which is called as the cyclooxygenase. Or ye jo enzyme hai, this is called as the housekeeper enzyme. That means this is required in the body. Now by giving this drug, you are inhibiting this enzyme. Now, the function of this enzyme is to protect your gastrointestinal mucosa. Now, if you inhibit that, the drug is going to perform its work. So people may develop the gastrointestinal problems. Like, as I said, some people might only complain about the mild gastric discomfort. Some people might complain about the burning sensations. Some people might develop severe ulcers in the stomach or the duodenum. Now, it also depends upon several other factors. Like, for example, are you taking other drug? It also depends upon are you taking them with meal or without meal? It also depends upon what is the age of the person. Because if you have more acidity in your stomach, The more acidity, the drug is more likely to cause gastric irritation. So we have to watch out for this one organ, which is the intestine.
Right.
The second organ that I have to watch out for is the bronchus, respiratory system. Because, and again, this is very important. Again, based on this mechanism of action, some people, especially those who have a history of bronchial asthma, if these people, they take the analgesic which is belonging to category of NSAID, there is a chance that this drug might precipitate acute attack of bronchial asthma based on their mechanism of action. So watch out, if you have history of bronchial asthma, the NSAIDs, they should not be taken without consultation of a doctor. There could be some special class of the drug that doctor might recommend you. This drug might be a suitable drug for you. Third important adverse effect with this analgesics is related to the kidney. There are chances that with a chronic use of this medication, or sometimes there might be with acute usage also, there are chances that your kidney might get impaired. The functions of kidney might get impaired. The fourth one, there could be a risk of bleeding tendencies, because this drug, they inhibit the function of platelet. And therefore, especially those people who are taking medication for thinning of the blood, is called in layman they say blood thinners.
Right.
If somebody is taking those kind of drugs and he is self-medicating with NSAIDs, there are chances that the risk of bleeding might increase. And obviously, some people might have adverse implications on the liver, and allergic reactions and all those, I mean, they are unpredictable. But at least these adverse events, which are more important and kind of more serious, I would say. So my brother has not developed adverse event does not mean that I will not get adverse event. Okay. I have a relative or a known person, a very old person, who used to take this kind of medication for arthritis. Because with these drugs, there was history that after taking this drug, there's a relief from arthritis. Old lady.
Yeah.
And then when required, popping up the pills.
Yeah.
And in one of the unfortunate days, she was found lying on the floor because there was internal bleeding. And she had to hospitalize, undergo surgery. So as I said, depends upon what are the comorbid conditions, what is your age. So there could be different type of adverse effects. So don't wait for those adverse events to happen. It's better that we know and be precautious or cautious to before we consume any drug without prescription of a doctor.
Yes. So don't copy any other person's prescription. Very important. And if you don't know what is NSAID, it's always a tongue twister for me. NSAID, then please, consult a doctor over phone also, and get to know about it. And so I have a very interesting question asked by Harsha. She's saying that I think what she means to say is like, some people have multiple medicines for blood pressure, thyroid, cardiac medicines. Now they all have, as per prescription, they can have different time periods to be taken during a day when you have to consume it after food or before food. She's asking, can all these medicines be clubbed together and taken? I think a lot of people do that for convenience. You know, even though it's prescribed sometimes, you know, after food in the evening, they don't follow it. So what's your take on that?
Okay. Again, a very important question. This is called as polypharmacy.
Yes.
Prescribing multiple medications to a patient. And this is required, especially people who have multiple diseases together. As the age advances, usually people, they develop chronic diseases like diabetes or hypertension, arthritis, and the doctor have no choice but to prescribe this kind of medications to that patient. Now, these medications are prescribed based on two reasons. One is called as the pharmacokinetic reason, and the other is called as the pharmacodynamic reason. Now, pharmacokinetic reason means, if you take a drug, after how much time the drug is expected to show its action, how long the drug is expected to remain in the body. which is the organ where the drug is going to get metabolized, and which is the organ from which the drug is going to get excreted out of the body. And pharmacodynamics means where is the drug going to go into the body, perform its action, and show the effect to the patient. Now, if you club all these drugs together, doctor has said that you take this drug in the morning and take this drug in the evening. And there's a reason why he has said so, because if you're taking two different drugs together, there might be pharmacokinetic interactions of these two drugs, or there might be pharmacodynamic interactions of these drugs. So that means one drug may have impact on the action of the other drug, either increasing the action or decreasing the action. So it may not happen with all the drugs, but if the doctor has specifically said that this drug has to be taken in the morning and this drug has to be taken in the evening, there is a reason why he has said so. So again, do not change the directions given by the doctor. Adhere to whatever he has said, because he has more knowledge than you. He has seen more number of patients than you. So you are just one patient for him. He has been treating such kind of patients day and day out. So he knows that which drug works better when given at what point of time and along with what kind of medication.
So Harsha, I think this answers the question, stick to the schedule. Don't change whatever your doctor is telling you. And if it is inconvenient for you, please discuss with your doctor. Ask if there is some alternative where, you can club everything and take together. It's always better with that. Dr. Anant, we have another question which says that how do we know which medicine we are allergic to? So I think this has no context, but I'm assuming a lot of times when people take medicine, especially when they're taking painkillers, they have certain allergic reactions. So then they want to know that, how do we know that they are allergic?
Again, it's very difficult to know that which medication are you allergic to. And that is why I said this is called as a bizarre response.
Yeah.
And there are four different types of allergic reaction that I was talking about. The first is called as the acute anaphylactic reaction. And the type four is called as a delayed reaction. If you are fortunate, you may get delayed type of response, which is not very serious. And it comes after maybe 12 hours or so. Those symptoms are not very serious. Yes. But if you're unfortunate, then there might be chance that you may get a type 1 allergic reaction, which is anaphylaxis. And these kind of reactions can sometimes be life-threatening.
Which come up suddenly, immediately after correct. Consumption. Yeah, that is anaphylaxis.
Correct. So, knowing that am I allergic to this particular kind of medication is very difficult. So allergic response, remember, does not happen with the first dose of the drug. Whereas the idiosyncratic response, which is a genetically mediated response, might happen with the first dose. For the allergy to happen, there is some time required for the body's immune cell to understand that this drug is a foreign substance. So once the drug understands this is a foreign substance, the drug or the body, there are some changes which happen. This is called a sensitization. So the body gets sensitized to this drug and body prepares itself so that whenever next time the same drug comes, I have an antibody developed in my body. So now you take the drug again second time, there is a possibility that you will get a adverse drug reaction in the form of allergic reaction. So to sum up, again, it's very difficult to know that you are allergic to some type of medication. But if you're allergic to some medication, if you know that, first thing that you do whenever you go to the hospital, tell the doctor that I am allergic to this kind of medication. Or if you have a file of previous admission, usually people tend to keep their record file.
Yes.
So on the file itself, you write in a bold letter and in a different color that I am allergic to this kind of medication. So even if you are not well or you are not in a position to talk to doctor, as soon as your doctor sees your file, on the top it is written that I am allergic to this drug, so that doctor won't give this drug to you. Or for that matter, similar drug from that particular category, which is possible to cause similar kind of adverse drug reaction. So one take home message, if you are allergic to a particular drug, make sure that you tell this to your doctor that I'm allergic to this drug. Mm.
I think this is a very important message, Joe, because, you know, people should have it displayed on there. So normally, you know, I put it on my phone. So if there's an accident or something, one, your emergency number should be there. And if you're allergic to certain medicine, even that should be displayed very clearly, because you never know when you would require what medication. So there is another question which says that we see people taking tablets for acidity almost every day. Is that okay?
Come again? Acidity.
A lot of people take antacids on a daily basis. So is that okay? They're asking.
Again, as I said, I will not be able to give you a specific answer for your specific conditions, because I have not seen the patient. It's always a good idea to consult your doctor for specific conditions because if I generalize the answer, again, people might tend to misuse the antacid also. Remember, antacids are also metals. So suppose somebody is having renal impairment, kidney impairment, and you're taking metals, like minerals. Mm. So these minerals may also be toxic to kidney. So again, as I'm saying, the person has to be seen holistically without knowing just I'm taking antacid regularly. Some people may tolerate, but some people may not tolerate it. Mm. For example, the antacids which contains magnesium is a laxative.
Yeah.
So some people, they may develop diarrhea because of magnesium. On the contrary, there's a aluminium which is a constipating agent. Hmm. So some people might develop constipation because of aluminium. Hmm. So antacid usually contains this kind of minerals. So usually there are combinations of magnesium and aluminium so that they can have counteracting actions with each other. So I would not generalize the statement saying that it is good to take antacid or it is not good to take antacid. So again, you have to holistically see what is the patient, because sometimes antacid might also have action or interaction with the other drug that the person is taking.
Okay.
Because suppose, for example, for some drugs, acid is required for absorption of some other drug. Hmm. And you are taking antacid, that acid is being neutralized. Hmm. So it might happen that the absorption of another drug will get hampered. So again, difficult to give an answer in a yes or no fashion for this question.
Right. It's a very specific question. Yes. So there is another question where they're asking, it is seen that doctor refers some drugs as allergic, like sulfa is common. Okay, it's like a statement, I think.
Yeah. Sulfur reactions are, sulfur drugs are very kind of notorious drugs, I would say, in terms of causing the skin reaction. So if you are allergic to sulfur drug, again, the same point I would reiterate. So you specify that you are allergic to this kind of drug, because sulfur drug is a category. So if you're allergic to one sulfur drug, it's advised that you should not take another sulfur drug, because the chemical structure is almost similar. So there are chances that if you're allergic to one sulfur drug, there might be allergic reaction to other sulfur drug also.
Okay. So, Dr. Anand, I also want to touch base a little bit about addiction and self-medication. Because a very close friend of mine, I know, keeps taking laxative like a drink, which is very weird. But I think it's a habit since many years now, 10 years, 11 years around. So, can you please talk a little about how self-medication can cause addiction, or, you know, it's not related?
Okay. Now, coming to this question, very important question again. There are different terminologies one has to understand. Hmm. So one terminology is called as abuse. Hmm. The second is called as habituation.
Yes.
The third is called as addiction.
Yes.
The fourth is called as dependence. Hmm. So people usually tend to use these terminologies interchangeably.
Yes.
But this is not right. Because every terminology has a specific meaning. Hmm. Now I will go in explaining the meaning of what is abuse, what is habituation,
right,
what is dependence, and what is addiction.
Right.
Now what is abuse is, in a given situation, at given point of time, in the given community, if the usage is not accepted socially, and not accepted medically, this is called as the abuse. So you're abusing a drug which is not socially acceptable, which is not medically acceptable. So it could be taking a drug once in a high quantity, or maybe regularly, but not is socially justified, not medically justified. This is called as the abuse. So some drugs might be abused. The second could be habituation. Now, habituation is there is a little less intense craving for the drug. The person wants to take the drug, but the craving is not to very high extent. Like for example, tea, coffee. So you want to take it, but it's okay even if you don't take it. So that's called as the habituation. Now coming to the third, which is called as the addiction. Now addiction is what is worrisome. Now addiction is the craving, or you feel that your desire to get that drug supersedes everything that is your routine activities. So that is called an addiction. So there is a difference between abuse, habituation and addiction.
Yes.
So the drugs which are having effect on your thinking or the feelings, so these drugs are more likely to be addictive. Then the person goes into dependence. And dependence is of two types. One is called as the psychological dependence, and the other is called as the physical dependence. Now, what do I mean by psychological dependence is my feeling or I think that my overall personal well-being or my overall response or normal living cannot happen without this drug. This is my feeling. This is called a psychological dependence.
Yeah.
So I feel that unless I take this drug, I will not be okay. Physical dependence is when you take the drug for a long time and you suddenly stop it, then you develop withdrawal symptoms. This is called as a physical dependence.
Yes.
So what the example that you gave of laxatives, laxatives might be abused. They might be abused. Now coming to back to the definition of abuse, I am taking the drug which is not medically justified,
right,
in a way that is not medically justified. That means it is not justified to take the laxatives for long period of time. Like for example, antihypertensive drug, anti-diabetic drug, they are medically justified to be taken for long duration.
Right.
So people, they develop laxative abuse. Why? Because they feel that unless I take this medication, they will not develop the motion. So this is called as the abuse. The dependence and addiction, they are more with the drugs which are centrally acting, which have effect on your mind or feeling.
Right. So also, since we are on the subject, can you elaborate on the immediate harms that can happen to a person if the person is, say, abusing a drug or is addicted to a drug?
Okay. It all depends upon what is the drug that the person is abusing. Because the adverse implications of that particular drug will depend upon what is the pharmacological profile of that particular drug. If the drug is getting metabolized in the liver and the person is abusing that drug, there is a chance that the liver might get impaired. If the drug is getting excreted in the kidney, the patient has been taking the drug for a long period of time, the patient might develop some kind of complication in the kidney. So it is depending upon what is the chemical nature of that particular drug. So I would divide this particular risk factors into three domains. One is the drug related issues. Second is the disease related issues. And the third is the patient related issues. Now, if I look at the drug related issues, as I was talking about, what is the chemical nature of the drug? What is the pharmacological action of the drug? If I see the patient-related factor, what is the age of the patient? Does he have other comorbid conditions? Is he taking another drug along with that drug? And finally, is the disease. What disease is person is suffering from? At what stage the disease is? So it's a complex interaction of patient-related factors, the drug-related factors, and the disease-related factors. So again, what will happen to a person is again difficult to predict, because I have to take into consideration the gamut of all these three things together.
Also, you know, we come, since we've discussed so much about why not to self-medicate, we come to a very relevant question in times of COVID, you know, because people are scared to step into clinics, they are afraid to go to hospitals. And typically, it has been observed that self-medication has really gone up in these 5-6 months of lockdown. So I want to ask your you know, recommendation of what people should do in such times.
Okay, again, very relevant question. And as you said, the usage of self-medication during COVID time is increasing. Again, I don't know whether it's hypothetical or whether it has been documented. I just read one study from Bangladesh, recently published study. Last 3 months, they evaluated through a survey-based study. They checked in terms of how many people they self-medicated during last 3 months during this COVID pandemic period. And to your surprise or my surprise, the percentage was 88%. Almost 88% people of that survey population. I'm not talking about generalizing. So this was a study from Dhaka. So 88% of the people, they self-medicated during this COVID period. On the contrary, we did a study. We means even I was involved in that survey-based study. And we found that the prevalence of self-medication was close to 16 to 17%. Now, why? Because our population was different. This study was performed by a medical student. And obviously, the responses that we received were largely from medical students. Given to understand, because they were aware possibly because of the adverse effects and the implications and all that. So the rate of self-medication in our study was significantly low, I would say. And this study possibly will get published in coming months, because we have just received a positive response from one of the journals. So what people should do to avoid self-medication. Again, it is not justified, whatever is the situation, whether it's a COVID or whether it's non-COVID, it is not justified to self-medicate without consultation or without guidance or without supervision of a qualified healthcare professional. Government of India, they have now officially approved the telemedication. So you might, I'm sure every one of us would have at least some contact with the healthcare professional. You know some healthcare professional. So my advice would be, do not self-medicate yourself. There would be advertisements, or there would be some people and the peers and the groups and the friends, they would be saying that, this drug has worked for me. I read somewhere this drug is very good for COVID. To your surprise, the prevalence of the self-medication in that study, which I'm quoting, the Dhaka study, the most commonly self-medicated drug was ivermectin. Now, ivermectin is being used by some doctors for the treatment of COVID. The second drug which was self-medicated by people was azithromycin. Again, a very commonly used drug. And it's not a secret. It's an open secret, rather, I would say. In India, you go to chemists, most of the places you would get this kind of medications without prescription. So we need to have a system in place to supervise, to get control, so that people, they do not misuse an important drug. The third medication in the study that they found was doxycycline. So doxycycline also has been misused in that particular study I'm talking about. So again, my advice is the same one. At least you contact some healthcare professional. You give your whole overall history to the healthcare professional. What is your age? What is your gender? What are the current medications? Your allergic history? Your other status, so that he selects a proper drug based on your holistic patient profile. So one drug, like one pill, may not suit all. So every person is a different person. So if one drug has worked for me, that does not mean that the same drug will work for you as well. So again, I would come to the same point: do not self-medicate without consultation of a registered medical practitioner.
Mm-hmm. So I have a question that says, what about health supplements?
Health supplements?
Yes, like vitamins.
Okay. So vitamins, generally they are regarded as safe and well-tolerated medications. So now coming back to a very important regulatory perspective on the drugs. Mm-hmm. So globally and India, there is some word which is called as the over-the-counter medications. Now, mm-hmm. over-the-counter medication means the medications for which you do not require prescription from a registered mm-hmm. medical practitioner.
Mm-hmm.
So, in India, we follow the regulations called as the Drugs and Cosmetic Act 1940 and the Drugs and Cosmetic Rules 1945. Mm-hmm. So, as of today, there is no word called as over-the-counter medication in this particular book. Yeah. But there are discussions which are going on at the regulatory level to officially give a list of medications to which you do not need to have a prescription from the registered medical practitioner. Mm-hmm. So different countries, they have different regulations.
Mm-hmm.
So every country would have their list of medications which are included into the list where you do not require a prescription from the registered medical practitioner. There are three or four factors which are considered when you say that this particular drug will not require prescription from a doctor. This particular drug will require prescription from a doctor. Who decides and what are the criteria to decide this particular drug which do not require prescription? So one is the drug or the medication should be used for minor ailment. If the drug is for use of some serious illness or severe illness, that drug should not be considered as the OTC. So that's one criteria the regulators would look at. What is the condition that this drug is likely to be used for?
Mm-hmm.
Second criteria, what is the safety profile, risk-benefit ratio of this particular medication? Is the, obviously, always the safety has to be more than the risk mm-hmm. involved.
Mm-hmm.
That's the second criteria. The third mm-hmm. criteria, which most of the countries they consider, is mm-hmm. since how long the drug is there in the market? And has there been any reporting of serious adverse event with this kind of a drug? So taking into considerations, the regulatory authorities will come up with a list that this drug will not require a prescription from the registered medical practitioner. So as of today in India, we have four or five different categories of drugs. One is called as the Schedule G drug, Schedule H drug, Schedule H1 drug, Schedule X drug, and Schedule G drugs. So Schedule H, H1, X, they all require prescription from the doctor.
Mm-hmm.
So if your drug is belonging to the category which does not require prescription, then mm-hmm. for example, this kind of vitamins, so they can be called as the non-prescription drugs. But again, you have to see the list, which are the drugs which are listed in the mm-hmm. prescription medications and the non-prescription medication.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think, Dr. Anand, that's really informative. I have a lot of comments from people saying very well explained. And I think I have one of your students asking, you know, what has been your experience in seeing self-medication? Because since you're a doctor as well, so what has been your experience with people?
I would say that most important thing is to keep your immunity to the level where you can fight the virus effectively. So whatever you need to do to boost your immunity. So one is before you develop COVID, what you can do. After you came out of that COVID, what obviously when you have COVID, you have a team of doctors for treating you and guiding you.
Yeah.
So one thing is you need to boost your immunity. Mm-hmm. And for boosting immunity, there are various nutraceuticals or the vitamins or the I would say that eat a balanced, healthy diet. So that's the prime thing. Do not think too much about COVID, because the more you think, the more you get stressed. The more you get stressed, the stress also itself has an effect on your immunity. So have a healthy diet, get adequate sleep. Do not go into crowd. Use your social distancing norms which are being given by government. So one point is that you take care of your immunity and follow the social norms. So I think these are the two things. When you have a COVID, after COVID, your immunity is already low. You might have lost some weight during COVID treatment. So you need to, again, whatever has been lost, you have to gain it up. So the diet, again, plays a significant role in terms of the post-COVID care. Maybe protein supplements or maybe the healthy diet, which provides you a good amount of proteins, those will be important. And again, the vitamins, which are important for helping the immunity, those kind of, again, but check with your doctor. The medication that you're taking, whether they are nutraceuticals or whatever, those also should be counter-checked by your doctor. If he is advising you, go ahead with it. So again, without doctor's advice, do not take any of the medication. So that's my, again, sincere advice to all of you.
So, Dr. Anand, thank you so much. It was lovely interacting with you. And would you want to give us last thoughts for all those viewers who are watching us right now, and probably all those viewers who will watch with us later? Before that, I have another question just come up. I think we'll take it also since we have time. What is the most common self-medication related adverse events or side effects that practicing doctors face in young and elderly in India?
No, again, it's difficult to answer which is the most common adverse effect. So I categorize few medications which are most commonly self-consumed. Right. One of them was the analgesic, that's a painkiller. There are some medications used for skin diseases. So depending upon which is the most commonly used medication, so if it is analgesic, the most common would be gastrointestinal adverse effect. So if it is the other drug, so depending upon that category of drug or medication, what is the prevalent adverse event for that medication? So it will depend or it will change based on the practice where you are practicing. It will depend upon what is the population that is coming to you. So again, giving a single answer would be difficult for this question. It will depend upon the drug what is being consumed by the patient.
Right, right. So Dr. Anand, any last message for all the audiences?
I think I have only one sentence to say. One pill does not suit all. So do not self-medicate because somebody has got benefit from this. Please, please consult your healthcare practitioner or your doctor for taking before taking any medication. So that's all from my side.
Yes, thank you so much. Very well said. So that one prescription that all of us get from a doctor, a lot of things and considerations goes behind writing that one prescription or one name on that paper. So please don't use it like a generic statement for everyone in the family suffering the same disease, because every prescription is very individualistic based on the condition, lot of factors that go through. And trust me, doctors work very hard in their academics and in their practice. They keep studying every year just to put that one prescription on your paper. So thank you so much, Dr. Anand. This was so good. I think it was a very relevant discussion. I had a lot of fun talking to you after a very long time.
Yeah, but same here, Hema. Thank you so much for inviting me and bringing this topic on the board for discussion. I really appreciate for bringing this topic on board. Thank you.
No, I am truly thankful to you as well. So for all the audiences who are watching us new, I want to convey to you that this platform is called Lose Your Blues and we promote stress-free living. We call a real-life hero who educates you on different topics commonly not commonly talked about and also helps you learn through their experience. So please subscribe to the channel and follow it and also share it with your people. Let us know if you have specific topics you want to talk about. And I want to thank you all. I want to introduce myself also. I keep it for the end because I have a lot of people who know me who come regular on the channel. My name is Hema Bajaj and I am a homeopath. I am very passionate about connecting two people and hence this platform. And Dr. Anand, a lot of our previous colleagues and friends are alive and they are all saying a thank you for this very informative talk. And hopefully, we will get together on the talk with another relevant medical topic sometime in future. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Hema. Looking forward for next talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you.